Today's program made possible by patrons like you. Welcome to another episode of What's the Score? Before we get to the program for today, I wanted to mention that if you're enjoying this podcast, consider becoming a larger part of the show. I've started a program where listeners can support our efforts through monthly contributions, and in turn get some goodies and perks with that. Now, if you want more information, you can visit our Facebook page for details, or you can go to www.patreon.com/whatsthescore. Now, What's the Score is all one word. Patreon is spelled P-A-T-R-E-O-N, patreon.com/whatsthescore, and you can learn more. The contributions are very small, but they help offset some of the costs that we've incurred, as well as I like to say, leaving a little tip in the tip jar, if you'd be so kind. Now, first of all, the show will always be free to listen to, so I want you to be rest assured of that. But I do want to reward dedicated listeners and also, quite frankly, just get a little bit of money for my effort. So if you're able to and you're willing, I'd really be grateful. That's patreon.com/whatsthescore. patreon.com/whatsthescore. Thanks very much. Welcome to where we celebrate music from the movies. From the golden age to present day, we've got it covered. We talk to those from the industry and learn about them and their favorite scores. Welcome to What's the Score? I'm your host, Frank R. Wilson. So let's take a look at the shelf of CDs and see what we're going to play today. Recognize that music? It's a favorite of our guest today. He's an Emmy-nominated and award-winning composer. Over 30 films and 60-plus TV shows have been supported by his music. Not stopping there, he's also composed music that are not connected to any films, and in fact, will have a new album coming out later this year. His credits, to name just a few, include films like The Last Starfighter and Remo Williams, and TV shows such as Cheers and Tales from the Crypt. Please join me in welcoming Craig Safan to the program. Hi, Craig.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good. I'm good, you know, good. Considering the circumstances we're in, which is kind of unusual. We're recording this when we're still all under quarantine, but I really very appreciative of you joining us today. We generally start off with trying to learn more about the individual. If you would maybe just give us a sense, tell us a little bit about yourself, primarily outside of music and before you got into that, but, you know, things like where'd you grow up and family and things of that type.
Yeah, well, I was born in Los Angeles. My father was born in Los Angeles, so we're the unusual Angelinos. Most people tend to have moved here from other locations, but
yeah,
I think we've been here since at least World War I, so I'm very much a product of Los Angeles and love living here and have seen it change over the years. My mother was from Laredo, Texas, actually, and she was a pianist. And after the war, got married and stopped playing piano. But I started picking it up when I was about 6 years old, and she helped me. She helped me learn the notes, but I was already playing by ear when I was six.
Wow.
And then when she got me, wanted to give me lessons, because she said, well, I'm not, you know, you shouldn't be taught by your mother. I should get you a teacher. She said, she had always played classical. And she said, you know, nobody ever liked listening to classical music at parties. It was a drag. I'm going to find you a teacher who teaches popular music, which meant basically, you know, the standards,
sure,
things like that, rock, you know. And she found this great teacher named Helene Mirich, who it turned out not only was a jazz pianist, but was a classical violinist. So she had both sides in that she could totally improvise anything with the best, but also could read anything. She's still a very close friend of mine. She's 90 years old now.
Oh, my goodness.
But she's great. And so she had me improvising from the very first lesson, and I loved ragtime. And I said, that's what I want to learn, how to play ragtime. And I remember the first piece I played was Alexander's Ragtime Band. And so I just always improvised, but because of her classical training, I still had to learn all the classical techniques, but instead of learning them through playing Beethoven and Mozart, I learned them through playing Scott Joplin. But it's still, you know, it's still the same technique, and it's not easy music to play. So that's sort of how I started. I started writing music when I was in junior high school. I started writing songs. I love pop music. So I started having bands. I was not really interested in classical music very much. And I had a band in high school. I had one band that was a jazz band and another band that was sort of a rock and roll band that played cover tunes like, you know, the Rolling Stones and Gloria, you know, from them and that, you know, that period.
Sure.
So I was just always playing music and writing a lot of songs. When it came time to go to college, I was also a really good artist. I could paint, I could draw anything. I was you know, very good at the visual arts. And when I went to college, I knew my parents did not want me to take music. And I really didn't even want to take music because I definitely was not an academic musician. And a conservatory, I wouldn't have even known what to do there because I was already playing things that were way, way more complicated than what you'd learn at a conservatory for your first 2 or 3 years. I mean, I was playing Bill Evans pieces, Thelonious Monk, you know, very complex things. And I would go see those people in Los Angeles. They all played Los Angeles in a club here called Shelley's Manhole. Shelley Mann was a great jazz drummer and he had a club. And my dad would take me to the club because I could, even though they served liquor, if you went in with an adult, you could get in. And so I saw all the great jazz pianists play there.
Wow.
And my teacher was amazing because this is, you know, long before digital recording. And I would say, wow, I want to play that Thelonious Monk piece. And she would not only write out the piece, but she would transcribe his jazz solos so I could see exactly what he was doing, which is pretty phenomenal.
Wow. Yeah.
So when I went to college, I went in as an art major saying, okay, I'm going to become an architect. But what I really found out, even though I loved art and painting and all that, was that I was spending more and more time just alone in the practice room, writing songs, writing original musicals, listening to classical music for the first time. I think the first classical piece I really listened to was Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring, which is sort of an interesting place to start. But that's because I had read Leonard Bernstein's book on music appreciation, and he mentioned that. So I thought, oh, I got to listen to that. And then at college, they had this weird place called the Electronic Music Laboratory. And I talked my way into that and would spend countless nights fiddling with dials and cables. And it was what's called a Buchla synthesizer. And this was before synthesizers had keyboards. They were just sound machines. That was the idea. That was the idea, was that music was sound. It wasn't notes. Music was legitimately just sound pictures. And that's how synthesizers began, people wanting to develop sound machines. So I did that. I wrote a number of original musicals for college. And because of my musical background, I was one of the only guys who could do pop music, but also could read, meaning read music and
read
write music.
Yeah.
And so people would come to me and say, wow, we're working on a record album at Warner Brothers. Do you know how to put string parts on here? I say, sure, I'll do it. And I'd read how to write string parts and hire people from the Boston Symphony. And so I did several records while I was in college. where I was already arranging strings for albums, and ended up winning the prize, senior prize, in both music and in drama at my university. And then I was awarded a Thomas J. Watson Foundation fellowship, which gave me money for a free year abroad to pursue my interests in a non-academic setting.
Huh.
And so I spent a year outside of London, living in a farmhouse, writing music, going into London, working on the electronic music scene, meeting people, and then traveling all around Europe, Morocco, Spain, all those places. You couldn't go to East Europe back in those days. That was like 1970, right. And that was still closed. But by the time I came back to Los Angeles, I was a pretty good musician, had written probably hundreds of songs, and knew a lot about electronic music, but also knew a lot about how to write music and how orchestras work, because I studied a lot of scores.
Well, and I want to get into that at some point, but I also want to also make sure that we have time for some of the cues that we wanted to play today.
Go ahead.
And we're going to feature your music today, so I would be grateful if you could kind of talk us through it a little bit. The first cue, I think, is called Crazy Horse Dreams. And can you tell us as to why you wanted to feature that as one of your favorite compositions?
Right. Well, I think you should start with what's called the Washita Massacre.
Okay, then, we can do that.
They're from the same show. This was a mini-series based on a wonderful book called Son of the Morning Star, which was a brand new revisionist history of Custer and Little Bighorn.
Hmm.
And it's fantastic. It's a really fantastic book, and I was really happy that I got the job to write it. And what I wanted to do was try to write the music for Custer and the European Americans using all strings with a few brass. But then when I would go to the Native American scenes, and I used the Native American flute player improvising on Sioux melodies.
Hmm.
And I would have him improvise watching the film. I would choose the melody, and he knew the melodies because they're in the tradition. And then I would add percussion and synthesizers to that, so that the score actually had two completely different sounds. The sound of the Europeans, which was very moody and like an elegy,
mm-hmm.
and the sounds of the Native Americans, which was Native American percussion and flute, but then with synthesizers, sort of gluing it together.
Oh, wow. We got to hear that. You've certainly piqued my curiosity.
So you could play the Washita Massacre to start with and get the idea of the main theme of the show.
Okay. We'll do that, and then that'll also be followed up by the Crazy Horse Dreams as well, both in the same film, Son of the Morning Star, written by our guest, Craig Safan. You said something that piqued my curiosity. You were glad to get that job on Son of the Morning Star. I'm curious, if for the most part during your career, did you pursue jobs or did jobs pursue you?
It works both ways, and you have an agent. You have an agent who helps you pursue jobs, and that one, I can't remember how I exactly got the job, but I was very happy because I loved the book. I had read the book because I'm sort of a history buff, and that was really one of the best American history books I think written at that period. And so I was, I was very, very up to doing it. I knew a few of the people involved. Maybe I'd worked with a few of them. But it definitely was a beautiful production and a very good miniseries. And I was extremely happy with the music. And I can point out something else in that if you look at my music, it goes all over the place in terms of style, from big orchestra to synthesizers to rock and roll to ethnic. So the first thing, the first thing I do when I look at a film is go, what's the palette? So it's almost like an artistic reference. What is the palette to this film? And so like how I describe the music to Son of the Morning Star, where each element, I went, this has this sound, this has this sound. So I give myself very specific outlines and limitations when I start writing. And I do that in all my films, which sort of leaves my body of work all over the place. So that's
just I did notice note. That, yeah, with the ones you sent me. Yeah, but it's fascinating to see how you can do that. Do you, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. I am curious, because we kind of danced around it, but what was it that eventually got you into actually writing scores for film and television?
Well, I came back from England and I was trying to make a living as a musician. I was, I guess, 21 or something. And yeah, it's a hard business to make a living at. And I was working part-time, like meaning a couple days a week. And my father had a retail jewelry store and I worked at that. And I met a group of musicians who were songwriters. And there was one person who had built a studio, who was older, built a studio to develop new acts. And then would rent out the studio during the day to other people to pay for it. And then his people that he was producing would record at night. And I was playing songs and writing songs with my brother, Mark. And this guy's name was Charlie Plotkin, who ended up being one of the producers of Springsteen years later. He brought us into the fold. And I arranged a lot of records. I wrote tons of songs. Some of them got recorded. But then, I was always on the edge, never really making any money almost at all doing that. And one day a friend called me from college who was the stage manager of my musicals when I was in college and said, hey, Craig, she had gotten married and her husband wanted to be a director and had enrolled in American Film Institute here in Los Angeles. And he had made a really cheap horror film on what was called Super 16, which was a 16 millimeter film. She said, you're the only person I know in Los Angeles who's a musician, and we need to put music to this film, and we don't know anyone. Maybe you would know someone. And I remember just saying, I'll do it. I did it, and I loved it so much. The film never got released, but I loved it so much that I went, this is what I should be doing. I should not be trying to write hit songs. That isn't my talent. My talent is a much broader canvas that isn't trying to hit this little teeny hit song bullseye every time, which is what a pop songwriter has to do.
Yeah.
And so that's how I got started. And then I just started pursuing it. But then the most interesting thing and this most serendipitous thing was that I looked around at some of the people I had been playing music with in this little group of musicians. And one of them was a bass player named Peter Bernstein. His father was Elmer Bernstein. Another one was a guitar player named Andrew Gold. His father was Ernest Gold. Another was a singer named Wendy Waldman. Her father was Fred Steiner, who wrote Perry Mason theme and Rocky and Bullwinkle and Star Trek. And I went, oh, your parents, and they had all gone to school together, which is how that sort of happened. I said, your parents are all film musicians. Oh, yeah, yeah. So I ended up calling all of them, and the three of them became my mentor. You know, and Elmer Bernstein, of course, is one of the all-time greatest film composers.
Yes.
To Kill a Mockingbird, The Ten Commandments, hundreds of other movies. Yeah. Ernest Gold wrote all the Stanley Kramer movies, like the theme from Exodus, which was a huge, huge hit when it was written, and Fred Steiner. And they all became my mentors and sort of, in different ways, helped my career and taught me about being a film composer.
Wow, so how lucky can you get?
It was purely luck. It was just
well, that, you know, that's all right, though. Things. You know, I mean, that is a lot of times a big part of life. Yeah,
no, it's a big part of life, and you know, it's being in the right place in the right time, and somehow
and being ready for that. Yeah, and being ready for that. And obviously, you were.
You have to be ready. If you're not ready, it doesn't mean anything.
Well, the next cue we were going to play, it's and you'll have to help me with this because I think it's. I don't have the full title here in front of me. Into the Starscape? Is this going to be from The Last Starfighter?
Yeah. So this is, I guess this is the music that I'm best known for today, all these years. This music, The Last Starfighter, is still performed all the time, all over the world by orchestras.
Hmm.
In fact, it's supposed to be performed near, in a orchestra in Orange County, near Los Angeles, in June or July, whether that's going to happen or not.
Yeah,
but William Shatner was going to conduct it, which was going to be such a trip.
Holy smokes. I didn't even know he did such a thing, really.
He doesn't, but the conductor, Richard Kaufman, who has recorded this piece, wanted to do something with William Shatner. So I have a feeling it's all going to be canceled because of this virus. But anyway, this is the final scenes in The Last Starfighter going into the end title.
Okay. All right. Well, let's have a listen. This is from The Last Starfighter, and just sit back and enjoy.
Thank you.
We'll get back to our guest here in just a minute. I was curious if you ever find yourself in a position where you like to kind of show off unique items of yours, maybe a coffee mug or a t-shirt that's, you know, something that not everybody can get. In our case, because you're listening to the show, I'm guessing it would be nice. I certainly would like it if I could find some kind of a film score mug or t-shirt that I could show off, you know, like pictures of composers and stuff. Oh, wait a minute. That does exist. What you have to do is go visit redbubble.com and search for What's the Score or search for Frank Wilson's shop. And there you'll find the logo to the program for our podcast. And it's available on mugs, shirts, stickers, and far more, all sorts of items. If you recall, our logo is a film strip with composers' faces on the different frames. So you'll see composers like John Williams, John Barry, Lalo Schifrin, and some others you'll recognize. So if you want to show off your love of film music, this is the perfect way to do it. Visit redbubble.com, that's redbubble.com, and search for either What's the Score, or you can also search for Frank Wilson's shop. And you can also visit our Facebook page and get more information on that as well. So I want to encourage you to check it out. That's redbubble.com, redbubble.com, search for What's the Score. You almost answered what was my next question, but perhaps there's some other things there.
Sure.
Because you had some great mentors. I mean, you know, giants really in the industry, which is absolutely fascinating. So I don't know if it's going to be the same people or not, but do you feel like that you've been influenced, or have you admired some other film composers and that they may have had some kind of an influence on your work?
Oh, absolutely. There's a lot of great film composers, and I think Elmer was one of the greats, because Elmer Bernstein, he could do so much with music and film. He could bring out the subtext of a film so well, meaning the music would tell you what was going on emotionally underneath for the characters, even if the characters' dialogue didn't express it, the music did, which is why there's music in film. I mean, why is there music and film to begin with anyway? It makes no sense at all. And yet there's more music than ever. And one of the reasons is because it expresses an emotional subtext. But the other composer, I love Max Steiner.
Okay.
These are from the Golden Age. Right. So Max Steiner did Casablanca, The Maltese Falcon, Gone with the Wind, countless movies. I love Bernard Herrmann, of course, who did all of the Hitchcock films, but also did Jason and the Argonauts, a lot of those sort of Harry Harryhausen sci-fi films. More contemporary, I love Dave Grusin, who wrote a lot of more jazz scores.
Right.
And I think also one of my contemporary meaning still working, Thomas Newman, I think, is a terrific composer, and I love Randy Newman. So those are people who I really think are doing great work,
and they have
done great work.
Yeah, that's quite a list. And what's kind of neat is, I guess you've had an opportunity, just by virtue of where you live and what you do, you probably have had an opportunity to meet many of those folks. Have you?
If they were alive, I met them.
Well,
I've been on the I was on the executive committee for the music branch of the Academy for over 20 years. And so I knew all the old timers because I was the young guy. And then when I started out and just was trying to break into the business, people would invite me to their sessions. So I would go see Elmer Bernstein. I saw him record The Shootist, which was a John Wayne's last movie.
Oh, yeah.
I saw John Barry, who was another amazing composer, one of my favorites, who did all the early Bond films, but also did Out of Africa. And
right.
I saw him record King Kong, the newer King Kong.
Okay.
So I was being invited to a lot of scoring sessions to see what it was all about.
Yeah, well, this audience will know for well, and I wouldn't expect you to know that, is that if I had to pick my absolute favorite, there's no question that it's John Barry. That's who I've always loved. And so I'm really, I think it's, yeah, wow, I would have loved to have been in one of those recording sessions. I don't know what it was like. But
it was fantastic because he had such a beautiful style in his music. I was just watching on TV, sitting home, all, you know, we're all under quarantine, right, watching, and Peggy Sue Got Married came on. Yeah. And that's just a great score. And then, of course, Out of Africa is one of the all-time best scores in the world. But then also Somewhere in Time, I think, is a gorgeous melody.
Probably the most underrated one. You know, I'm just shocked that didn't get nominated in some way or fashion.
I think because it was also using Rachmaninoff in that score, and I think it sort of confused the music palette, as it were.
Yeah.
But that's a great score. I love it, and I love that movie, Somewhere in Time. But, you know, Out of Africa is the ultimate, and of course, Dances with Wolves is an amazing score.
Well, you mentioned something. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you mentioned something that I think he always tried to do, or so he said, because he used to like to consider himself in his later years as a musical dramatist. But he said there's, well, let me see here. He had said that what he tries to do a lot of times, unless it calls for something different, he is trying to express what's going on in the characters through music. And you're saying that's kind of like what Elmer Bernstein did. And I love that approach.
Well, that's the job. I think that's the job of the composer, is to express the subtext and express what, because it's music is an, enters one's body involuntarily. So it's not like you have to look at a movie with your eyes and then run it through your brain and think about whether you like it or this and that and make judgments. Music bypasses all that. Music goes straight into very deep parts of your brain that have been around since the beginning of humanity and affect us. And affect us whether we want it to affect us or not. We have zero control over music short of putting earplugs in. And so that's why the music in a film just is what hits you. Like when you're watching Peggy Sue Got Married and that music comes on, it's like you get tears in your eyes. You can't help it. And that's what John Barry did so well.
Yeah. And most people haven't had the opportunity like you do to watch a film with no music, and it's amazing how flat it sometimes can be.
Totally.
Without having the score, it just loses something. So in your view, and I'm not saying whether it's good or bad, but it's just an objective observation. Do you find that there's like a lot of music or more music than in films than there used to be? It seems to me it's like sometimes it's almost wall to wall music for a talkie, and
I think there is. I feel that there is, but I haven't done any measurements, but I think we go through different phases and styles, like everything else. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a period when films had very little music. If you think of the John Cassavetes films and things where people didn't really want music, and the only music was music that actually occurred literally on the film, like if you walk into a club and there's a band playing. But I think we're almost back to where they were in the late 1930s and 40s, where there was a huge amount of music in film. And that started again really with Spielberg and Lucas with Star Wars and movies like that, where they were literally imitating the style of scoring of the old movies. And now, especially with all the, Avenger movies and all that, those kind of movies just demand pretty much music from start to finish. Mm-hmm. All the superhero movies, because the music is what propels it and adds to the sort of magical feeling where you buy into these characters and these worlds.
And what prompted me to ask you that question too is I thought you said something very appropriate, very right on as far as I'm concerned, and that is silence. There are a lot of times that can be just as powerful as music, you know,
absolutely
picked at the right time. So, all righty.
Well, yeah. always in horror films, you play all this ominous music and then you stop. Mm-hmm. And then the audience is off balance because they don't have that rhythm anymore. And that's when the big hit comes. That's when the knife comes out. So there's always silence can be very unnerving in a film and put you off balance. You can't know, you know, when the monster is going to pop out or whatever. So
yeah,
it's definitely part of the tools.
Not bad. That's another composition of yours that you had wanted to play is the main title from a film called Mr. Wrong.
Right. So this was an interesting film. Unfortunately, it didn't do very well, but it was Ellen DeGeneres's big move into movies.
I remember and now. Okay.
It was a big flop, but yeah, you can play it. It's interesting. So it's sort of very wacky. It was a black comedy and the music is very, very extreme. All the sounds are big brass sounds, big guitar mm-hmm. sounds, big piano sounds. And it's fun. And it has a Latin feel because a lot of the movie took place in Mexico.
Okay. Well, let's have a listen. This is the main title from a film called Mr. Wrong. I'm kind of curious because you've had such a varied career. So you've written for both film and television. Do you have a preference for one medium versus the other, and how are they different?
Well, television, of course, has changed dramatically over the years. When I started out, people said, "Oh, don't do television. It's second rate, and no one will take you seriously." But of course, now television and cable has totally taken over movies. I mean, 90% of the people watch movies on television now. They don't even go to the theater.
Mm.
And a lot of the really good music, if you think of like Game of Thrones or something like that, is being done for TV. So that whole dichotomy between television and film has pretty much disappeared. But the big difference is that on television, you have very strong time limits. And you don't have as big of, at least when I was doing a lot of television, the budgets are not as big. I mean, Son of the Morning Star was a good size budget. That was a big, big score. But generally, it's just you go in and you have to do it, and then it's going to be on the air in 5 days. So there's not a lot of anxiety and not a lot of second guessing. In movies, such as that movie, Mr. Wrong, there was nothing but second guessing and anxiety and backstabbing and craziness coming from Disney and not knowing what to do with Ellen, because at that time she was starting to come out and the movie was a romantic comedy where she wasn't gay and this and that, and you know, and it was just, it was a painful experience for everybody. And that, so movies can be much better because you can take a lot of time. And also, like in The Last Starfighter, you can have a 90-piece orchestra for a week. You know, I mean, yeah. It's fantastic. But television, there's something just more quick and you just do it. So I've done a lot of both. And they're just different. But basically, I write the same for both. You have to figure out what your budget is and just go for it.
I know a lot of times you would might have to do demos or those sorts of things for films. And this is before the computer came into play with it, and you'd have to play the piano and, you know, for a film. But for TV, I guess because it was so fast paced, if you got the job, you don't have to worry about doing demos. Just do it. Is that safe to say?
That was certainly true, but usually on a new series, you would have to demo a main title.
Well, okay, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, I had to demo a lot of main titles, and some I got and some I didn't, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right that making a demo was much, much more costly and time-consuming and complex. Now I can do it in an afternoon in my studio on the computer.
It's amazing.
But then you would obviously have to hire a room, pay for tape, which was very expensive, have an engineer, and bring in actual people who played instruments. So it was much more difficult, which meant it wasn't used as much. They didn't make as many demos.
And yet you kind of need to do that because a lot of directors wouldn't, it's not their fault, but it's hard to imagine what the full sound's going to be like.
Well,
like just hearing a piano or something. Yeah.
Yeah, but they had to use their imagination.
True. Yeah.
They had no other choice. You'd play some examples. Maybe if you were doing Star Wars, you'd play some big romantic symphonies or Holst, the planets or whatever. And then you'd play your theme on the piano and say, but it's going to sort of sound like that with trumpets and big orchestra. And they'd have to go, I mean, they actually had to use their imagination. Now they want to hear everything totally finished and then, you know, start changing it 8,000 times. So it's a different, it's just a different challenge.
I bet. Well, one of the films that you're most well known for is called Remo Williams. And it's where I was, as I recall, introduced to your music about these films. In fact, I was curious, was there ever a plan to have a series of films on this? I mean, you know, kind of like the Bonds or whatever. Okay.
There was, but the movie didn't do well enough. But there's still talk of a new one being made. I mean, I think there's a new, even all these years later, there's a script. And I heard there was going to actually be a new one made, because it is a series of books called The Destroyer that's super popular. I mean, there's about 60 books. So, yeah, that was the idea. And the person who directed Remo was Guy Hamilton, who directed, I think, Goldfinger, a lot of the early Bonds he directed.
Yeah.
So, excuse me. So they were definitely going for that. It just didn't work out.
What was it like working with him?
He was great. He was fairly detached. He came over and listened to the music. I had mocked up the main themes. At that point, we had a lot of synthesizers. And he loved it. And it had a very strong Korean subplot.
Mm.
So I used a Korean folk melody as one of the melodies. And also I planned to use, in terms of the palette, to use a big orchestra, but to use lots and lots of synthesizers. And then also to bring in a Korean orchestra. So you had, instead of doing sort of quasi Asian sounds, which seemed horrible to me, actually do the research of what Korean music actually sounds like. So I would go and spend hours at the UCLA ethnomusicology library listening to tapes of Korean music and talking to Korean musicians, because we have a big Korean population here. And of course, this is before Spotify, and you could just listen to 1,000 Korean things in your living room. But
I know
there you actually had to go, and it was a much more difficult. But so I ended up actually finding a Korean orchestra in Los Angeles, and they played on it, and that was challenging. So it's a very complicated score. I think it's the most complicated score I ever did.
And yet, if memory serves, did I not just see some kind of an announcement that it either is going to be re-released, or I'm talking about the score?
The music is. So right. The music has already been released twice on two different CDs. And now they got the original tapes,
masters,
and they've done a whole new digital transfer, which is fantastic. And I think right now it's being released anew on CD, on Note for Note Music. And then the plan is in a few months they're releasing it on vinyl.
Oh, wow. Have you had a chance to hear it?
Yeah, it sounds amazing. In fact, this is from the album, the one that I sent you, the main title, is from the new album. So it's the best sounding I've ever heard it since we recorded it. So.
All right. Well, excellent. Let's have a listen to this. This is the main title from the film Remo Williams. I know that you've also written things outside of the film and TV community.
Sure.
I was wondering if you could kind of tell us a little bit about that, because you have done some music independent of those sorts of things. And is it jazz, or is it, you know, you have a certain style or thing that you like to do outside of the film world?
Well, I'm on my third album now. I've had two albums released, and I don't know what you'd call it. I don't think it fits neatly into any genre. You know, everybody's going, well, what is this? Is this new age? Is it, you know, there's a million Google music genres, and you'd be surprised what the charts, the flow charts you come up with. It's mostly orchestral music, and it's music that's a combination of live instruments and electronic instruments.
Mm-hmm.
The first, I guess all you can say is they're thematic, because I'm basically a dramatic composer. So the first one I released was called Rough Magic, and it was based on impressions of Paleolithic cave art. So I had always loved the paintings, from between 40 and 15,000 years ago on caves of early man. And I'd visited some of them back in the late 70s. But I went back and I recorded in the caves and got all the reverbs from the caves and sounds, and then wrote impressions of what that was like. And that music is pretty avant-garde. It's not like you're going to walk away humming it, but it's really intense and interesting. And then my second album is, I've always loved the Odyssey. So I thought, well, let's do impressions of the Odyssey, and let's try to find a bunch of the locations where the Odyssey maybe took place, even though we don't really know. But most of it, people think, is around Sicily in North Africa. Mm-hmm. So I went to Sicily, and again, I found all these places. I recorded sounds and got inspired and enjoyed Sicily, which is a great place.
Yeah.
And that's called Sirens. And that one came out, I guess, about 2.5 years ago, if that. And that's very melodic and very accessible. And I really like it. I feel it's a really nice album. And my new one, which I'm trying to finish right now remotely, I'm working with musicians where we send each other files. We're never in the same room anymore. It's called LAXEX. And it's about, I figured, well, instead of going to northern Spain and southern France to see prehistoric caves or go to Sicily, I grew up in Los Angeles. Maybe I'll write about all memories of Los Angeles and how it's changed. So that's what that's about.
Oh, wow.
And it's coming out really well. I'm really enjoying it. And I'm supposed to hear a lot of the violin tracks today, so it should be, it's a lot more fun when you're in the room with the players and you can sort of do a back and forth. But right now you can't really do that. So that's my new album. I think it'll be released on Note for Note Music, and at the end, probably I would say at the end of the year at this point, because I think we have at least another month and a half to finish it, and then by the time the package is put together. So that's what I've been working on.
Now it does strike me, though, that you still kind of, as an inspiration, had either a story or visuals.
Right.
That's
what I said. I'm a dramatic composer, and I like dramatic music. I like music that has a story attached to it. Now, if you just put this music on and you didn't know the story, it's not like you're going to know what I'm writing, because there's no, but that is the inspiration for me. And I do like writing dramatic and pictorial music. I really enjoy it.
Well, speaking of that, let's listen to another cue that you had passed along. This, let's see, the main title from East L.A.?
No, it's Stand and... The movie's called Stand and Deliver.
Okay, pardon me.
And Stand and Deliver was probably the most seen movie I've ever done. It's a classic at this point. It's been shown in schools all over the world. It's the story based on a true story of a teacher in East Los Angeles, which is at the time was mostly a poor Latino neighborhood. And he decided he was going to teach his students AP calculus. And he did. And that's the story. In fact, James Olmos played the teacher, and he was nominated for Best Actor Academy Award that year. And this is really one of those films that just has influenced and touched so many people and been a very inspirational film. So this is about East L.A., the main title. And you can hear a lot of Latin and also South American influences, but all the percussion is done with instruments that I sort of invented and put into computers.
Oh, wow. Well, excellent. Let's have a listen to this. This is, again, the main title from the film Stand and Deliver, written by our guest. Let's have a listen. Write strictly for the purposes of the film, or do you sometimes also keep in mind, I want this to work as a standalone piece as well? Does that make sense what I'm asking?
Yeah, but I learned really early on, and I mean, if you really think about it, over the years of film music, there have been very few film, and certainly recently not at all, there have been very few pieces that have lived outside of the film. It's almost impossible to think of one, except if you say, okay, I'm going to hire Adele to write a song for a James Bond movie. I mean, you know, or Billie Eilish to do that. But in terms of the orchestral music, it almost doesn't even exist as a possibility. Mm-hmm. The last one may be, I don't know. I mean, Gone with the Wind was a big theme. The Pink Panther, I guess, was a big theme at that time.
True, yeah.
But what I learned, and what I really learned from Elmer Bernstein, was that the music is doing a job in the film, and that's what you've got to do. And if it lives, like he wrote the, what was it, the Magnificent Seven, you know, bum, right. bum, 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 that became a big, well-known theme.
Yeah.
If it lives outside of the movie, that's great. You know, like Rocky was one. But that isn't really what you need to think about. Unless you're writing a song for a film that is specifically meant to be a hit and be part of the promotion of a film. And probably, you know, I mean, the last one written by a composer, because it used to be that the composer would write those songs, but for the last 20 or 30 years, it's mostly they'll go outside of the composer and go specifically to songwriters. But the last big one was Titanic, which was written by the composer, James Horner, the theme, what is it called? My Heart Will Go On.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't happen very often anymore. And it's not a big consideration.
Which I think is kind of a shame, because I always liked hearing that theme kind of replay itself during the course of the movie. It really added a good connection to the song and the movie itself. Yeah. Well, there's another cue you had mentioned or listed. I think it's on a dolphin's back.
Right. So that's from Sirens. That's from my album.
Oh, okay.
And the inspiration is that Odysseus was thrown into the sea and attached himself to a fish and, you know, made his way. And so I just sort of tried to picture what that would be like. And that's this piece of music.
Well, okay. Yeah, this is the piece you were talking about that was inspired by the Odyssey. So
that's correct.
All right.
One of the tracks, yes.
Yeah. Let's sit back and enjoy this. The cue is called On a Dolphin's Back.
Thank you.
You already mentioned one project that you're working on right now. I'm just kind of curious if the future holds anything else for you other than that album right now. Are you looking beyond that?
Not really. I'm putting all my energy into this album and finishing it. I've been working on it for, I think, almost a year and a half or 2 years because I stopped in the middle to do the Phantom of the Opera. And then also last summer, there was a big concert where they used some of the music from Sirens and did modern dance to it, but I had to reorchestrate it for a symphony orchestra, and that took a couple months to do. So half of last year was sort of taken up by other things. So right now I'm just finishing this album. When I finish it, I'm also teaching a course in why music works in movies. I'm teaching a course at Chapman University, and then I also gave a
Oh,
lecture at to the film school. Then I also gave a lecture actually on Zoom about the same thing a couple of weeks ago to the USC film school. So I've been sort of putting my thoughts down as to why there's music in film and teaching it as a professor. So that's sort of where I'm at. I'll probably start thinking about the next album at some point.
But just because we don't see your name attached to any kind of a film or TV series does not mean you're not staying busy. It sounds like you are staying
No,
very busy.
I'm always busy, but I think as far as film music goes, I don't know that I'll be doing much more of that. I did it for 30 years, and that's probably, I'm very thankful that I could make a good living for all those years. Now I'm enjoying
Yeah, no, that's
it.
good. Yeah, that's. Like Bill Conti kept crediting what was the theme from Rocky was paying for his kids' college, and then he came up with another piece of music. Well, this paid for that, and it's all, yeah, it's kind of funny how that
Absolute,
works.
absolute. Listen, Cheers. We didn't talk about Cheers, but Cheers is still running all over the world every day of the week. I mean,
Did
Cheers
yeah,
just goes on and on.
and I don't want to. I promise I won't spend a lot of time. But did you wrote the score for that show for a number of years, right? But the title song was someone else.
I was hired by Jimmy Burrells, who was the director and producer. He already had the song, and he just said, "You want to do the music to this?" And I said, "Sure." And it was sort of a side gig because it didn't take very much time, and I was doing all these movies at the time. Yeah, for 11 years, I
Wow.
wrote the background, the background music. I produced the song. I produced. I was the producer on it and ran the session. But you can hear me playing piano and everything. I play piano and everything on Cheers, and I wrote all the what you call incidental music or background music for 11
Right.
years of all 11 years of Cheers. So that's a nice thing. We get royalties on all that music
Yeah,
when
the
it plays.
residuals are sweet on that, right? Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well,
So.
Craig, look, I can't thank you enough for taking the time to be with us today. I also know, and I should tell our listeners that he took some time out of his busy schedule to help put together the program and send all the cues to us. So I don't know how else to say it other than just a simple thank you. I really appreciate it. I hope you enjoyed it.
I did enjoy it, and thanks for asking me. And it's a nice thing to do in the middle of quarantine. You have to keep busy and keep your day varied,
Yeah, indeed.
and not eat
Well,
too much pasta. So, also, like, what day is it? You forget what day it is.
I
It's
know that's
a
actually
very
happened to
weird
me.
feeling. Yeah,
That's happened to me a couple of times, and I'm shocked.
absolutely.
I mean, I really have to think about it. What is today?
I know. I have to
It's
look at my
crazy.
computer up.
Let me
Anyway, it was
just.
a pleasure, and if anybody wants to hear more of my music, you can just go to my website,
Which
which is
is.
just craigsaffin.com, and you can hear tons of music on that.
Excellent. Very good. And I appreciate you sharing that.
Okay.
Yeah, that's going to wrap it up for us. There's only one thing left to say, and that's simply this. My name is Frank R. Wilson. My time's up. I thank you for yours. Thanks for listening to What's the Score?